All right, let's get started. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the second installment of the Interstellar Probe Study webinar series. My name is James Mastandrea, and I'm the Deputy Study Manager for the Interstellar Probe Study. Thank you very much for tuning into today's webinar. We have a wonderful presentation today that gives a year two update of the Interstellar Probe Study. And after the presentation, we will have a question and answer session. Before we start, I would like to outline the logistics of today's event. As a member of the audience, your audio and video are off. During the presentation, please submit your questions in the question and answer feature. You may also upvote questions. During the question and answer session, I will start with the questions with the largest amount of upvotes and proceed down the list. Also, for more information about the Interstellar Probe and for information on future webinars, please visit the Interstellar Probe website. And now I'd like to introduce today's speaker. Dr. Ralph McNutt is a physicist and a member of the principal professional staff at the Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Laboratory. Dr. McNutt has been a leader on multiple space flight missions, exploring the solar system from the sun, past all of the planets, including Pluto, and out into the interstellar medium with the Voyager spacecraft. He has also served on multiple National Research Council committees, focusing on the tools and technology needed to maintain America's leadership in space exploration. He has been studying and considering exploration of interstellar space from an early age, including a treatment of the subject in his junior year at a small high school in Texas. He is the principal investigator for the ongoing four-year Interstellar Probe Study of a pragmatic mission concept to explore the nearby pristine interstellar medium. And today he will be giving a year two update of the study. And with that, Dr. McNutt, the floor is yours.
Thanks, James. Good afternoon, everyone. So without ado, there we go. Thank you, James, to the first page. So this current study that's going on right now started back in the summer of 2018. We went through, gave a brief to NASA headquarters. This is all coming out of the Heliophysics Division of the Science Mission Directorate. They liked what they saw. And so we started up in the next phase back in the summer of 2019. Right now, what we're doing is work that's very similar to the early concept work that was done on Solar Probe at Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Laboratory between 2002 and 2004 that led to Parker Solar Probe that was launched coming up on 2 years ago now. So the output from all of this is going to be a technical report to be delivered to NASA headquarters late calendar year 2021 to help out as input to the next Solar and Space Physics Decadal Survey. Next, please. So you can ask what this is. It's called Interstellar Probe. It's a mission through the outer heliosphere into the nearby very local interstellar medium, sometimes called the VLISM. And the idea here is to look at what we can do with using today's technology to take this first explicit step onto the path of interstellar exploration faster than the Voyagers, using more powerful launch vehicles. We've been focusing on the SLS, and I'll say some more about that, or a commercial equivalent. And the idea is that this could pave the way for more ambitious future journeys and more ambitious science goals. It's the idea that we keep building on what we do, but you have to start somewhere, and this is sort of the first step in all of this. Next, please. So let me just say what this is not. It's not about interstellar travel. There's actually been a lot of technical work that's been done. People did a lot of concept papers throughout the 20th century. Robert Goddard sort of started this with his pen to note on what he called the Great Migration back in 1918. Zonder in the Soviet Union speculated about relativistic space travel by people. All of the notions of relativistic rocket mechanics were worked out mathematically. Looking at what it would take in terms of energetic, and everybody pretty much concluded that this is a really hard thing to do. Next, please. So the other thing that's been speculated about is even colonization. Perhaps I can go more slowly, but take more people with me. Actually, J.D. Bernal speculated about this in 1929. There have been others since then that talked about that. One notable work was by Stephen Dole, Habitable Planets for Man, that was a RAND study in the mid-1960s. And there's been other speculation since then. But again, we're not talking about going to Alpha Centauri. We're talking about getting out into the interstellar medium between us and there. Next, please. So what sort of started off this this idea of looking at the interstellar medium was a meeting in 1971 about looking at solar system escape. And this was really motivated by what was then pinned as the forthcoming flights of Pioneers F and G. Well, once that they launched, those were Pioneers 10 and 11, which were, of course, the first probes that went past the asteroid belt. And this got people thinking about, well, okay, we know by that time, of course, we knew about the solar wind. We knew that at some point the solar wind would have to run into the interstellar medium. There'd been a lot of theoretical speculation. A.J. Dessler, who's one of the people on this paper, had actually done a lot of the writing about that as well, that about what that interaction might look like and what it might take to actually get too far enough away from the sun that one could actually study that. Next, please. So if you go back to the beginnings of NASA, there were three special probes that were outlined by, this is by what was called the Simpson Committee. It was committee number 8 of the what was then the Space Science Board. This is at a meeting in 1960. John Simpson of the University of Chicago was the chair. Van Allen was on it. Quite a few other people were on it from the early era of space. And they were looking at what you could do and what would make sense in terms of compelling science for exploration. And they came up with respective fields and particles with three special probes. One would be a solar probe designed to go very close to the sun. One would be an outer solar system probe to be aimed away from the sun in the plane of the ecliptic and go out as far as and as fast as possible. And a third would be a probe that would be going perpendicular to the plane of the ecliptic. If you could have the next time step, please. And of course, we've done two of these. So the one at the bottom, it was Ulysses. We did manage to get pretty much perpendicular to the plane of the ecliptic and got a better idea of what the three-dimensional heliosphere looks like, the bubble in the interstellar medium blown by the solar wind. And of course, Parker Solar Probe, as I mentioned before, started a couple of years ago. So it was gradually making its way using Venus gravity assist closer and closer to the sun. So the one that hasn't been done at the time was the one that people also had said it was probably be the simplest one. And that was really doing what would be what we're calling today an interstellar probe mission. Next, please. So the questions that one can look at scientifically, they're not new. These were actually looked at in some detail at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in a study that was done in 1976 to 1977. It was documented in a paper in Icarus called Science Aspects of a Mission Beyond the Planets. This was published in 1979. And the main objectives were to characterize the heliopause, indeed look at the heliosphere overall, get into the interstellar medium and see what would really be out there, determine the characteristics of cosmic rays, and really look back at our overall system and see how it interacts with the interstellar medium. There were secondary objectives that also had to do with looking at planets. For example, at that time, Pluto certainly hadn't been explored. There had been no plans, and there was talk of actually taking a probe up and dropping it off by Pluto to go into orbit on the way out of the heliosphere. There were also questions being able to look back at the extragalactic background light, possibility that would be enabled by being away from the dust that's in the inner part of our heliosphere. If we could go to the next one, please. So those questions really haven't changed that much because we're still trying to reach out and understand about our role in the local interstellar medium. We've changed some of the words a bit. We talk about our habitable astrosphere. We know for a fact that we do indeed have this heliosphere that blows this bubble in the local interstellar medium. And by looking in the infrared, we've been able to actually see similar structures around other stars out there. We know that this must be common We know that this has got to be somehow related to the habitability of our own place in the universe. We know that the exoplanets are out there, and the question is, how do you put all the pieces together and to be able to do a better job at that? We really need to get out of our own heliosphere and take a look, because this neighborhood's the one that's actually accessible to in situ measurements. Next, please. So the Voyagers, Voyager 1 and 2, of course, are still operating almost 43 years past their launches. They were really the accidental interstellar explorers. They were designed to last for 4.5 years, so they've outlived their warranty by almost a factor of 10. They are running down with respect to power. Of course, the technology and the instruments that were used in the payload date from the 1970s and were really mainly focused on the planetary targets that the Voyagers were going by. We are out into the interstellar medium, at least most people think that, with the Voyagers. We've gotten past the heliopause with both. We still don't understand some very general things about the force balance between the particles and fields distributions and that of the local interstellar medium. The topology, there is some new debate about what the shape of the heliosphere looks like. Is it more spherical? Is it more like a windsock? We know that there's some sort of a hydrogen wall out there, a buildup of neutral hydrogen due to the interaction. But again, we don't have a good feel for what globally that looks like. And we certainly have been able to see with the Voyagers the change in the amount of cosmic rays going across the heliopause and be able to see what it looks, that spectrum looks like outside of the heliosphere versus the amount of cosmic rays that leak into our own little bubble here in the interstellar medium. Next, please. So there is also opportunities across disciplines. Again, this was something mentioned back in the 1976-77 JPL study. Of course, we've been by Pluto now with New Horizons. So the tables have been turned. Instead of using dropping a probe off to Pluto on the way out of the interstellar medium, New Horizons is now in an extended mission, having gone by Pluto, gone by Arrokoth, the small Kuiper Belt object back on the 1st of January of 2019. And it too is joining that fleet, comprised of Voyager 1 and 2 and the now silent Pioneers 10 and 11 going out into the interstellar medium. We know about the circumstellar dust disk. We actually see counts of dust particles with the dust detector on board New Horizons, as well as with the plasma science instrument on board the Voyagers. And we know that from looking at exoplanet systems, that this is a common feature of star systems that have exoplanets. And then finally, the question, the extragalactic background light, which was talked about in the JPL study, is still a big question mark. And we still, is something that, again, if we can get away from the dust near in the inner part of our own solar system, it's still another window that to be opened and to be able to understand something more about the very origins of the universe. Next, please. So what we're doing in this study is really adopting what we've called a menu approach. This is not a science definition team. It's not a science and technology definition team. We're not putting together a mission. We're looking to see what pragmatically is possible in the near term. So part of the charge to us has been to engage the science and technical communities that are out there. We've had a couple of workshops over the last couple of years. We're going to have another in New York City. We're going to have another workshop, and the plan is to have it locally in the Baltimore area this coming fall. It will be larger and it will be virtual if it has to be. We'll see, we're keeping a close eye on that. But the idea is to pull in everyone from around the world in terms of ideas and to put together a menu of what has been done and what can be done. And the point is, if I go into a restaurant, typically, I would like to hope, you don't order everything off of the menu at one sitting, but rather you make a choice. And this is something that a science definition team would do. But you would like to be able to have the assurance that if I order something off the menu, that it can actually be cooked back in the kitchen. And so that's what we're really doing, is we're putting together the menu and making sure that if a future science definition team can place an order, it indeed can be delivered. And we're also going to be looking at the cost of what these things are, because again, if you're in a restaurant, typically you might want to know what things are going to cost before you place the order. Next, please. So we put together, again, working with a lot of people, both within APL and on the outside through these workshops, the notional science state traceability matrix, trying to look at some of the requirements for various mission designs, looking at the questions, the objectives, measurements, and the mission phase that might be used for accomplishing these. And again, sort of starting from the very beginning, and then going back and comparing with what was done back in the late 1970s. Things have not changed that much. Even with the Voyagers out there, we still have a lot of very fundamental questions about what the nearby interstellar medium looks like. And so we're continuing to refine this, and again, basically updating things to what is doable now, and community input is greatly encouraged on this, and again, we continue to reach out for that precisely. Next, please. So again, part of the menu is having the instruments, what kind of things, there's various measurements you would like to make, and then it's a question of how would you make them. And so one of the things that we have been trying to do is to take a very hard look at some of the instruments that, again, one might like to be able to fly. We're not going to fly the whole Christmas tree full of ornaments. That's something that probably is not going to work because there are mass and power limitations, as there are on any mission. I'll be talking a little bit about those. But what we have been trying to do is to, again, to reach out, get an idea from members of the community of, well, what's out there and what are typical masses, what are typical powers, what are typical data rates, and to, again, to try to start filling in that menu to have a better understanding of what you might be able to do and what it would take, and because all of this is at the core of what that you do for putting together a spacecraft system that could accommodate various options. Next, please. There's also a question of notional operational scenarios, trying to identify the architecture drivers. We're going to have, if we're talking about a mission that's going out to several hundred AU, which is the current idea, things are going to be different depending upon whether I'm in the inner heliosphere, whether I'm in the outer heliosphere, whether I'm through the heliospheric boundary regions, and then what about being actually into the interstellar medium itself. And all of these are going to have challenges. We have to worry about data rates. We have to worry about how much power we've got on board, whether we're spinning or not spinning. A lot of the details that typically are not thought about too much, except when you're actually developing a mission initially. And so again, trying to put everything out on the table and see what all the interactions might look like in terms of trying to drive what we need to look at for that menu. Next, please. So for example, another piece of this is looking at flyout directions. Again, I'd mentioned that one of the questions is whether that the heliosphere really is symmetrical or whether it's not symmetrical. This has bounced around for a while. There are things that you could go and see on the way out. And for example, Kuiper Belt objects. For example, here, if I can have the next time step on this. Just to give you an example, one could think about going out on the flank of the heliosphere, maybe 90 degrees from the direction of the incoming interstellar medium. Next, please. If you did that, it would give you a unique vantage point. Next, please. You'd miss the Ibex ribbon, though, for example. The Ibex ribbon, of course, this is the ribbon of energetic neutral atoms that are being created by as part of this interaction between the heliosphere and the interstellar medium that the IBEX mission and has been so successful at being able to collect the data on. And we're going to have more on that with the upcoming IMAP mission as well from the Heliophysics Division. Next, please. Depending upon exactly where you go, some of the Kuiper Belt objects such as Haumea or Makemake might be accessible or even for example, another flyby of Pluto, such as was done with New Horizons. Next, please. One of the ways of doing this is passively with a Jupiter gravity assist. I'll say a little bit more about that. There's some ways that you would get out there. It may be on the order of almost 8 AU per year. And next, please. We're also looking at what you could do with a powered maneuver Jupiter. So these are just, again, a snapshot out of a subsection of that menu of some of the things that we were trying to think through, trying to gather information from the community about in terms of thoughts of what one might want to actually do on such a mission. Next slide, please. So the central question has always been propulsion. It's always been this issue of, well, okay, so how far can I go and how fast? And this was true of the Simpson Committee. It was true of the JPL study that was done. It was true when this was being debated in 1971. There have been many, many studies that have been done since then. And this is always the thing that comes up. And it's also true that the near future, quote unquote, capabilities have always been the backdrop for defining the science requirements in a lot of these studies. But the real issue really has been to unite compelling science with engineering and technical reality that you can do. I can come up with incredibly compelling science, but if I don't have the means of doing that for the next 500 years, it's not very helpful in terms of really moving the state of the art forward. I have to somehow be able to pull those two competing things together to see what I can do with what compelling science that might be there. And that's what we're trying to do in this study. It's a philosophy that people end up adopting for proposals that end up being successful. For example, under the Discovery in the New Frontiers program and the Planetary Science Division. And it's also the philosophy that led from Solar Probe, the studies that were done in the early 2000s at APL, up through actually getting Parker Solar Probe launched in August of 2018. And that's the philosophy that we're adopting and applying here. Next, please. So the mission concepts we're looking at are all ballistic. We've looked at low thrust in space propulsion concepts, but they're all limited by the mass to power ratio of what that the actual power plant is going to weigh and in terms of what it can take out. We're looking at three different options. These again are not new. One would just simply be to make use of a passive Jupiter gravity assist, going very close to Jupiter and using Jupiter's gravity to give me a very large increase in my flyout speed. Another one is to trade off and use an upper stage at Jupiter. And instead of going into orbit around Jupiter, which is what we've done with stages there before, but to actually fire the stage at closest approach to Jupiter and increase my speed that way. And there are some trades between those two options. And then finally, there's the so-called Oberth maneuver, a powered solar gravity assist. It also makes use of going by Jupiter to slow down, kill off my angular momentum going around the sun so I can drop into Jupiter, or drop into the sun rather, fire a rocket engine, and as Oberth pointed out in 1929, if one can do this, then potentially you can get out of the system very, very rapidly. But there are challenges. For example, and the obvious one that was pointed out by Oberth himself, you really have to think about the thermal environment. There's also a question of guidance and control. You have to worry about the fact that if I've got a solar shield that I'm now pointing toward the sun, in order to keep my spacecraft from melting, and I fire my rocket engine as the fuel is being depleted, I'm changing the center of gravity of my system, and so now somehow I've got to control the system so that the thermal shield doesn't get off of the sun. And that's challenging and tends to add mass. So these are things that haven't really been looked at in detail in engineering studies that have been done before, but we're digging into those to really try to see what really is doable and where the physical limits really are. We've been looking at 22 different staging architectures. This has been based for the most part on the SLS. We have reached out to some of the commercial vendors, but there have been issues with, as one might guess, about the proprietary issues about some of the data that would be, it's really necessary for really, really looking at the space as much as we would like to in terms of the trades. We've looked at five different trajectory scenarios. So there's about 110 cases that we have been going through, again, mostly making use of the Space Launch System. We've been working with colleagues at Marshall Space Flight Center now for about 3 years. Been very, very helpful about helping us to know what's there, what kind of stages that we could add instead of going to the moon, as will Artemis, with without additional upper stages, and really trying to explore what could be done. Next, please. Just for one example, we've actually gone through. These are diagrams giving you an idea of what the upper shroud area of the SLS looks like. We've actually done mapping diagrams looking at various upper stages. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Here's six of the configurations here. And for example, just even mapping out what kind of residual volume that there is for being able to put a spacecraft. Again, things that typically are relegated to very detailed engineering studies, aren't necessarily out there in public until one has worked through a variety of point designs. But we're doing all of that right now. Next, please. The other thing that we've taken a look at is if you're going to use a Jupiter Gravity Assist, and the reason for doing that is that you can increase your speed by a lot if you go by Jupiter. But of course, you're also limiting exactly where that you can go for a fixed point on the sky, because it takes Jupiter 11.86 Earth years to actually make one revolution about the sun. So if I'm going by Jupiter and I'm gonna optimize my speed going out, I have to pick some time that corresponds to that heliospheric longitude in order to do the launch. And so again, that's across almost a 12 year period. That's mapped out here across the x-axis, again corresponding to the ecliptic longitude. I'm always going to be able to pick up more speed if I'm closer to the plane of the ecliptic, just simply because I can make better use of Jupiter's orbital velocity vector as I get swept around by Jupiter going around the sun. So these contours are plotting what that my asymptotic speed out of the solar system would be. You can see that these are clumped together. The sort of islands are spaced about 13 months apart. That's the synodic period of Jupiter as seen from the Earth, because in order to make good use of these gravity assist trajectories, I need to have the Earth and Jupiter aligned correctly. And so the redder areas correspond to faster flyout speeds. And if I could go to the next one, please. So in terms of doing that, I have to somehow have some knowledge of what my overall mass is for my spacecraft, and that devolves down to what the mass is for my payload. So again, with respect to this menu outlook, we've had to do some parameterization. We're looking at various options. The options really are looking at sorts of payloads I might have from a heliophysics core payload. I might have an augmentation of maybe having a camera for looking at a Kuiper belt object on the way out of the heliosphere. We label that as a planetary augmentation. And we've also been taking a look at what we call an astrophysics augmentation. It would be something that would enable me to perhaps actually image our own dust disk as on the way out, looking back in, as one does with exoplanets, looking from the Earth out, and also be able to take a look at the extragalactic background light, which I'd also mentioned, which would be accessible along the journey of a probe well outside of the heliosphere. We parameterize these in terms of payload masses of 40, 80, and 120 kilograms. For reference, the Voyager payload was at about a little over 100. The New Horizons payload was a little under 40. And the Pioneer 10 payload was at about 25. And of course, as I go up in mass, the flyout speed that I can get that corresponds to the previous diagram is going to go down. So we've split these up into looking at, looking at a core payload. Right now, we're concentrating on the 80 kilogram case for an in-situ plasma physics payload. That's the green bar that's in the third column. There are other columns that are out here because depending upon whether that I want to go by a Kuiper belt object, whether I want to have a dust analyzer, what kind of plasma wave measurements that I want to make, All of a sudden, these can turn into drivers very rapidly in terms of the mass and the propellant needs, and the guidance and control needs that I need on my spacecraft. And so again, trying to cast the net very widely in terms of what sort of options that we might have. Next, please. So engineering requirements always bound the box on what's possible with a mission. And you have to start somewhere. And so we have four main engineering requirements that frame the study. These don't necessarily locate a given point, but rather give us a box with outer limits. And so these have to be taken as being independent of each other as a starting point. So for readiness, we're looking at what, aside from policy and from money, something that could be launched no later than the 1st of January 2030, really taking to heart this idea of having a near-term pragmatic mission that, in principle, you could actually launch during the time frame of the next solar and space physics decadal survey period. Downlink, being able to operate from 1,000 astronomical units. 1,000 astronomical units is a long way out. And so there are a lot of drivers and a lot of trades that one gets into and needs to for the telecom system and the power system that's driven by that. Right now, the Voyagers are sending back about 160 bits per second of data. Voyager 1 is approaching 150 AU out. And so again, we're looking at something much more strenuous than that in terms of requirements. For power, we're looking at something that one could launch with no more than 600 watts of power required and still have about 300 watts of power left at the end of the mission. These requirements are typical of what one can get with a plutonium-238 powered RTG, the kinds that were actually flown on Cassini, Galileo, and are flying now on New Horizons and on the Voyagers, and about equivalent to the sorts of design goals and requirements that NASA is looking at right now for the so-called next-gen RTG, which is be flight ready by the year 2028. And then finally, we're looking at longevity questions. Have a lifetime of not less than 50 years. Now, the Voyagers, again, have been out there for 43. We think that they will last for 50. Depends exactly on the, as the power drops down, what instruments that we may turn off between now and then to conserve power. But again, that was not the design point. The design point for Voyager at launch was 4.5 years. The design point for New Horizons at launch was at about 13 years. And we're going to, we think, exceed that by, actually, I guess we already have exceeded that. And the spacecraft is doing just fine. But it's always difficult trying up front to say what your requirement is for a lifetime. And quite frankly, 50 years is over and above anything that's ever been designed for before in the space business. So we've engaged with the AIAA at their space ops meeting that's going to be in Tennessee in January. And there's going to be a special session there looking for concepts and features having to do with how do I build a really reliable, very long-lived spacecraft. And I believe that the abstracts are already open at that for that. So take a look at the AIAA website. Next, please. So the critical trade-offs are certainly not new. Again, the mass you have to worry about because E equals 1/2 mv². And the energy that you're going to get for the launch is going to come from the launch vehicle. And we're going to be looking with the SLS and some upper stages at the most you can possibly get. And that means that as the mass of the payload goes up, the mass of the spacecraft goes up, and the speed that I can fly out of the system will come down. So intimately, at some level, there is a trade between what kind of science you're going to do and how much and how fast that you can actually leave the system. So that's one of the things that we're taking a close look at, being able to quantify what those trade-offs look like. Communication, We're not looking at optical comm, and the reason for that is that optical comm is a great idea if you can point your spacecraft well enough. And I'll say a little bit more about that, but it turns out that is actually a challenge at these very, very large distances. And so there's a question of how well you can point versus the data rate. But in any event, we're focusing on radio frequency communications and what we know will work and can be made to work with appropriate extrapolations in terms of how we're doing with efficiencies on some of the subsystems. Next, please. And for example, with respect to telecommunications, of course, we're developing Ka band. Ka band was important for getting data back from Cassini. X band is what's used on the Voyagers. And the figure that's on the right of the screen gives you an idea of what the normalized data rate looks like for Ka band versus X band as a function of the pointing error. And typically for a spin-stabilized spacecraft, something we put New Horizons in most of the time, something that is usually more user-friendly for fields and particles measurements, and was used, for example, on Ulysses, have problems with being able to point very accurately. It turns out that right now the current pointing capability is about 0.2 degrees. And if you look at this, chart, you'll see that if the best I can do with the pointing accuracy is about 0.2 degrees, I actually win out with X band most of the time in terms of what sort of a data rate downlink that I can get. The break-even point is having a capability of about 0.08 degrees. And you can say, well, but Cassini did that, but Cassini had reaction wheels. And reaction wheels will not last for 50 years. So this is one of the trade points, again, that we're looking at about how that these various requirements very subtly interact with each other in terms of actually trying to put together an overall system that can deliver on maximizing the science from these extreme distances away from us out in space. Next, please. Again, the enabling technologies are not new. I've already hinted at this. The GPHS RTGs and the MHW RTGs that are powering the Voyagers right now, these are not new technologies. The converters that are used are not new technologies, but they are tried and true, and we know how to make them work. Again, the aim point for the next generation RTG is to be able to do at least as well as these. The current MMRTGs are not as efficient, and they have a much faster decay rate or degradation rate of the converters. So one of the things that, again, one of the aim points for the next gen RTG effort is to get back to where we were with these older units, which simply have to be in a very hard backend to operate. Again, propulsion and launch vehicles, they really are the keys for implementation. And we are looking at the cargo version of the SLS Block 2. This is the sort of vehicle that will be developed for being able to take larger loads of cargo to the surface of the moon as part of the Artemis program as we build up a human presence to stay on the surface of the moon. Except here, instead of flying a lot of cargo, we're talking about flying a couple of upper stages along with a very much smaller spacecraft. Next, please. So right now, where we are with all of this, again, we started back in, started with a vengeance with the engineering side in the fall of 2019 with our workshop, looking at the science, looking at the CONOPS, again, really polling the community. Since then, we've been engaged in a number of engineering studies that, again, are focused on longevity, focused on instruments, focused on the trajectory and launch vehicle, focused on the communications, the guidance and control system trades, focused on looking at the heat shield and really trying to dive deeply into finding out to what extent that that an Oberth maneuver at the sun would really be possible. And by the time that I put all of the pieces together to enable that to be flown, do I end up still coming out ahead or not? So we're deeply in the midst of those trade studies. We're also deeply in the middle of looking at various mechanical layouts. We've got a a preliminary block diagram for the spacecraft. We're starting to look at the trades if we're one to put instruments with fields of view with respect to the high gain antenna. That's something that's going to dominate the spacecraft, as it has dominated Cassini and the Voyagers and New Horizons, and indeed as it dominates anything that you're trying to get data back from these very, very far distances. And finally, again, as I touched upon, the power. Now, the plan is that by the mid to late summer, we'll be pulling all of these pieces together with a concurrent engineering study. We'll have an interim report. We will be reporting out at various meetings and at the workshop coming up this fall, using that as input to make some changes as needed, iterate through the system. And again, in the process of trying to educate the worldwide community on what is and is not doable, pulling in the information from that same community in terms of what the priorities might be to make sure that we haven't missed any of the points. And then we'll be going all through all of this again, tightening things up and looking at an overall cost estimate, not unlike the recent planetary exercises that are going on to support the planetary decadal survey with some concept studies, and have that as something to deliver back to NASA headquarters and to the community in late calendar year 2021 to help to support the deliberations that will be going on in the next decadal survey for solar and space physics. Next, please. So if you want to stay in touch, there's a website out there, http://interstellarprobe.jhuapl. There's a sign-up sheet to be able to be notified about this upcoming workshop, be able to take a look at things that we're developing and the studies that have been done. We're not as populated as well as we'd like to be yet, but we're still doing a little bit of playing catch-up, but we're getting there. So this is the way to stay in touch. Next, please. And this just gives you an example of one scenario. This is actually a launch opportunity on the 24th of February, 2030. It would enable us to go by QUAR, one of the KBOs, something like 6 years after launch, if we wanted to. This is an SLS Block 2 cargo launch out of Cape Kennedy. And gives you an idea, this is care of our colleagues at Marshall Space Flight Center. Of course, we've got the solids on the side, sort of the zeroth order stage, and then the two-stage SLS itself, an all cryogenic vehicle burning liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen. And if I can go to the next step, as we go up, first thing we do is we will be going with this vehicle standardly into a 100 nautical mile altitude parking orbit. We'll be able to get out of that orbit with the second stage of the SLS. Probably fire up a Centaur upper stage. That's something we're looking at, similar to the second stage on the current Atlas V launch vehicles or its extension. Then with a Star 48B, the solid engine out to Jupiter, prograde gravity assist, and then rapidly out of the system. In this simple scenario, take something like our Voyager-ish payload up to about somewhere over 7 and somewhere under 8 AU per year, probably. And that's pretty solid. And of course, for reference, Voyager 1 is the fastest thing escaping the sun we've ever built at about 3.6 AU per year. It's actually traveling faster than New Horizons because it went in closer to Jupiter and got more of a boost from Jupiter's gravity. Next, please. And so from the sun, next, to the stars, next, the real journey has only just begun. So it's kind of our tagline for this, and we'll go to the question and answer session. And again, thank you for your attention this afternoon.
Thank you very much, Dr. McNutt. And like Dr. McNutt said, we're going to go to the question and answer session. So the first question for you is, can the power and communication systems last for the length of the mission?
Well, that's one of the things that we're taking a close look at. We think that it's doable. We think looking, again, drawing a lot on the, looking at the Voyager system. So of course, Plutonium-238 has got a half-life of about 87 years. And what really sets the degradation on the power supply is degradation in the silicon-germanium converters, which have an effective half-life of about 40 years or so. So from what we've been able to see and from all of the studies that have been done over the last several decades, we think that 50 years is doable. And we think that a degradation in the power output of only a factor of two, going from 600 watts to 300 watts, is also probably doable, and that those are probably realistic numbers. For the communication system, again, we're digging into that. We're talking to a lot of people out there with a lot of experience on comm systems. Again, Voyager is kind of the gold standard because the Voyagers have actually lasted longer than anything else that we know of. Typically, if you look at commsats that are orbiting either in LEO or in geosynchronous orbit, they're typically designed to last about 15 years, and then typically they're parked because by that time I've run out of guidance and control fuel and or the technology has changed. And so we tend to not necessarily run spacecraft all the way to their absolute endpoint. What is clear is that as long as you can last the first few years in space, you're probably good for a long time because we're not going to be going through a very heavy radiation belt exposure except at Jupiter on this one. And so overall, the environment's pretty benign. So we think we're going to be okay, but we're taking a really close look at it.
All right. Thanks, Dr. McNutt. So the next question is by David Corn, and I'll note too that Wayne Schley, who's actually running the numbers on this, has some interesting feedback in the Q&A box, but I'll let Dr. McNutt also give his feedback. And the question is, if a JGA trajectory is used, could carefully timed flybys of large Jovian moons on the inbound slash outbound side of the JGA further increase the speed for the mission?
The moons don't have enough mass to actually really increase the speed that much. The real issue is going as close to Jupiter as possible. We've flown things in. Juno's gone into like 1.05 Jovian radii. Of course, that's been in a near equatorial orbit. One of the things, if you're going to be near the plane of the ecliptic, and which will also be near Jupiter's rotational equatorial plane, is you got to make sure that you don't run through the middle of the dust rings. And so we haven't looked in depth at those yet, but we will be looking at that as part of the study. And I don't know if Wayne is on out there and wants to comment or not.
Unfortunately, with the setup, Wayne can't comment right now.
Okay.
If
I've made any mistakes, I'm sure he will correct me, and that will be fine.
Okay, thanks, Dr. McNutt. The next question is from M.W. Warner, and it is, you didn't specifically say how long it would take you to pierce the heliosphere, but waiting until then for science results is going to be pretty debilitating. What is the balance between trans-Jovian KBO science and truly interstellar science in your thinking? Are there interesting particles and field studies within the heliosphere?
Oh, and the answer to that is, oh, absolutely. I mean, what we're talking about here is going to be we'll have a flyout from Earth to Jupiter. We'll take probably on most of these trajectories something from not more than 9 months, and some of them as low as seven, depending upon how big of a mass that we have. And I mean, already with the kinds of new instrumentation that will be available, we'll be able to do new science even there. And of course, we need to have the instruments on anyway for being able to deal with calibration issues. And this is something we've learned over and over again. Once we get into the outer heliosphere, already with being able to have a changing point of view, if we've got an energetic neutral atom imager on board, we'll be able to already be picking up new science there. The expectation is, with the kind of instrumentation that you would want anyway for particles and plasma to be looking at the near interstellar medium, that you're going to want to, you're already going to be making some interesting observations. I mean, you have to keep in mind that we've only had, again, five spacecraft that have gotten through this realm of the heliosphere. and that those are all five one-dimensional cuts. And we're always learning something different every time we go. You go through different regions at different phases in the solar cycle, which of course is about 11 years. And so it's, you know, it's not like a planetary encounter. You're actually doing the science along the way. And so it's not as if that you're going to wait for 50 years and then have the great aha moment and you're not going to learn anything on the way out. I mean, already right now with the New Horizons mission, we're learning things about the outer heliosphere and the outer solar wind that are brand new because the instrumentation on the Voyager simply wasn't good enough to be able to make the measurements. So it really is all about a voyage. It's not just about a destination.
Okay, and we have time for one more question, and that is, how much could be gained by developing a folding / expanding antenna that results in an antenna that's larger than 5 meters?
Well, we're taking a look at that too. And there's a lot of trades with respect to worrying about unfurling your antenna, of course, and about worrying about the launch loads on the antenna. There have been a lot of developments that have been made in antenna structures since the, of course, I think everybody's familiar with the issues about the antenna on Galileo not unfolding. And so as a result, we ended up having much reduced data rate from that mission from Jupiter. So it's certainly some sort of an unfolding mesh antenna is certainly something that is in the trade space and we're looking at. You have to worry about, again, how well that you can point it, how well that you can deploy it, because you have these very, very small angles that you've got to develop. We've talked some about being able to effectively shim it, if you will, electronically. And so this is part of the ongoing engineering trades that are going on. And it's a focus of a lot of discussion and debate and study right now. So we'll have more to say about that this fall at the next workshop.
All right. That's all the time we have for today. Thank you very much, Dr. McNutt, and thank you all for attending today's webinar. The next webinar will be on Thursday, June 11th at noon Eastern Time, titled Our Boundary to the Interstellar Space, A New Regime of Space Physics, where we will have a panel discussion by Dr. Elena Pavornikova, the lead scientist for heliophysics for the Interstellar Probe Study, Professor Mirav Ofer from the Department of Astronomy at Boston University, and Dr. Jamie Rankin, a space physics postdoctoral research associate at Princeton University. Please visit the Interstellar Probe website for more information about the study and to view information on future webinars and events. Also, please consider signing up for our listserv under the Community Involvement section of the website to make sure that you're getting the latest information on upcoming webinars and events. Thanks for joining us and have a wonderful day.